Vanaka, you're watching Talk Business, and to all our viewers who are joining us from around the region via Sky Pacific, welcome to the show. Now this week on Talk Business, you're in for a treat because we're going fishing. That's right. We conclude our coverage in Papua New Guinea, and this time we're featuring villages that actually farm tilapia in the Shirinumu Dam in the capital city of Papua New Guinea. Join us as we take you through the entire process, from the hatchery to the incubator to the nursery, grow out and then straight to the market. That's all coming up in the next half hour. It's about 2 hours up to the Shirinumu Dam from Port Moresby Town. We've been told it's a bit of a bumpy ride, but it would be all worth it as we go further into the highlands. The Shirinumu Dam is located in the Lalaki River, found in the Songere Plateau, which is around 800 meters above sea level. This road leading up to the dam is quite popular, as it's the starting point for the famous Kokoda track that even Australian soldiers used during the World War II. Not long after, we arrive at the infamous Lalaki River that has been dammed to provide Port Moresby around 63 megawatts of electricity. It's a beautiful part of PNG, especially Port Moresby, that many are not accustomed to. A big contingent joins our team to witness just how cage marine farming works. It's not every day you get to see a caged tilapia farm in the middle of a dam. We're also taking tiny baby prawns to the farm. These will be raised alongside the tilapia. The prawns have been raised in a nursery and are now ready for the wild. And we're off. Why they say the bumpy ride up to the Shirinumu Dam would be all worth it. How often do you get to see breathtaking views like this?
Now, after a 2 hour scenic drive into the Songere area, we then continue our journey with a 30 minute boat ride over the river that leads to the dam. Now, this is where we'll meet villagers that farm tilapia through a unique pan culture process. Now, just so you know, this river here is infested with freshwater crocodiles. Not that I'm worried or anything, okay, maybe just a little. But anyway, this is a unique farming process where farmers work very closely with officials from the European Union-funded IAP project, as well as officials from PNG's Fisheries Department.
As we approach the cage farm, we're not quite sure what to expect. And we were certainly in for a surprise. It looks like a large wooden jetty-like platform in the river. There are 12 individual cages, which has different sizes of tilapia in it. This is what pan or cage culturing of marine species is all about. Jonah Babongi hails from Bausaka village and lives on an island in the reservoir. He decided to venture into aquaculture back in 2005, focusing on farming tilapia. Aquaculture, in fact, isn't all that new to PNG. It was introduced in the highlands back in the 1950s in a bid to combat malnutrition with increased protein consumption. and enhance the livelihoods of small farmers like Jonah, relying on rivers and lakes. Today, he is the proud owner of 6 breeding ponds that produce an impressive 20,000 fingerlings, or young fish that is developed to about the size of a finger. These 12 cages produce around 24,000 table-size tilapia every 3 months and can easily earn him over 12,000 kina. Jonah owns this vast land which he once used for agriculture. But when the government decided to dam this river, his land turned into a big body of water, which is why you still see these stumps of rubber trees. Often he would hold the government to ransom and shut down the hydro plant in exchange for royalty. But today, this tilapia farm has become his source of survival.
I normally go and shut powers and all this just to get the money from government to pay me for my land compensation. But after I realized that it's not good for me to do this. So I have a lot of water here. I have to use this water just to farm tilapia. So I just have this kind of feeling that I have to try and look for ways and means to try to farm tilapia. So I did my way up to make my way up to fisheries and went in there just to ask the fisheries if they could assist me in farming tilapia.
Jonah started off the business with a $7,000 investment, and it has exponentially grown over the years. He now works closely with a cluster of 5 active farmers who also specialize in the cage culture method of farming tilapia here. Helping farmers like Jonah is the European Union-funded Increasing Agricultural Commodity Trade, or IACT, project. IACT works very closely with the National Fisheries Authority of PNG and identified a group of farmers who had the potential to venture out into large-scale aquaculture. But that great potential was hampered by 4 major obstacles. Now, the fish feed that these farmers used were of poor quality, below the 20% required protein feed, and the cage materials could not withstand the elements. There was also an inconsistency of supply of baby tilapia, and farmers had no formal record keeping of tilapia production levels. IACT came to the rescue and sorted out these issues.
We managed to find a company in Asia which they are supplying a UV protected cage material, which is perfectly for cage farming of tilapia. For the tilapia fry supply, we managed to set up through this EU IACT assist, and we managed to set up this incubation system. This has never been tried in the Pacific. In the Pacific, there's none of this sort of incubation system to produce baby tilapia by collecting the eggs and culture them right up to their fingerling size. So this is one of the first for the Pacific, the incubation method system. And the fourth issue that we found out was the record keeping. Through this IACT EU project, we managed to publish and print and supply the farmers with the proper record keeping booklet. So now all the farmers that we are assisting, not only in PNG, but all throughout the Pacific region, we are supplying them with this record booklet for their proper record keeping.
EU assistance has done a lot to me because it provides a net, it provides a feed, it provides an incubating system, and really that really helped me, you know, at least in the long run, my families can be benefited from what actually is happening. You know, I just had a support from the EU, which is very good. They did a lot to me.
Now, aquaculture isn't a simple task. Jonah needs to feed his fish stock at least 3 times a day and monitor the progress made by the different sizes of tilapia daily. Each cage carries a minimum of 3,000 fish.
Normally we get the fingerlings there. From there it has to come in here for about 21 days. For about 21 days it has to come through the hopper here, the cage net here. Then after 3 weeks we have to do the sampling just to get the body weights and all this, and to calculate how many feet to give to the fish.
And he is a fearless man. They call him the local crocodile hunter because, believe you me, he isn't one to shy away and evidently puts up a fight with these reptiles.
I'm also a crocodile hunter. Normally I hunt crocodiles, so there shouldn't be a problem.
Jonah's house is perched up on this little island that he now calls home. His growing family are committed to the business and hope to one day run the country's largest aquaculture venture. So much so, the determined farmer hopes to increase his production to 26,000 kilos or 26 tons of tilapia a year from his mere 5 tons. And this incubator plays a huge role in reaching his goal. Set up by the European Union-funded IAC project, the incubator will help him increase his production and control the tilapia right from the larvae stage. Doesn't it look rather interesting though? His incubator is powered by solar energy, also provided for by IAC.
When you're comparing these two farming techniques, especially for tilapia, the pond culture and the cage culture, pond culture, the water is not that consistency. It's not that consistent. For cage culture, water is coming from all the angles. So the water exchange is there at its maximum. That's why we're trying to preach this cage farming where there's a large water body to do cage farming, because the production is there, the survival is there, and it'll sustain. Definitely it's going to sustain the farm.
The production system, especially from fries up to fingerlings, the production system will be going up because I have already in place the incubating system. And shouldn't be a problem because now the current solar pump is working, and I'm really glad. That will help me in the long run. And also it will benefit my whole immediate family too.
The entire process from the hatchery until the fish is ready for the market takes about 7 to 8 months, which is why the incubator is an integral part of the entire hatchery process and could very well determine the success of the tilapia production. So how exactly does the incubator work?
Oh, we'll just collect the female and check them out manually, individually. We try and open the mouth and check if the egg is there. When we check the egg, if the egg is there, then we clean it and put them in basins. When you collect the eggs, then you treat them with a few chemicals, formalin and iodine, just to take away any bacterial infection. Then from there, we put them in incubators. Incubators is just like the mother's mouth. When the eggs are in the mother's mouth, they goggle the eggs. They goggle the eggs in the mouth, just to uplift the eggs in the mouth. So we are doing the same thing in the incubation method, in the incubation system. The eggs are inside, and with the water flowing in, it just keeps on lifting the egg, lifting the egg. So the eggs will be there, for example, a stage one egg, it'll be in the incubator for about 5 to 7 days. 5 to 7 days, then you'll see the egg yolk is fully absorbed. Then it will swimming down into the collecting trays. In the collecting trays, then we'll leave them for another 3 to 5 days. From there, all the yolk sac is fully absorbed, so they're ready for feeding. Because for the last 10 to 14 days in the incubation system, they're just feeding from the yolk egg.
Now, the National Fisheries Agency of PNG has been involved with the Tilapia Cage Cluster project since its very inception. In fact, it was the NFA that helped identify potential farmers like Jonah that could make the aquaculture project a success.
Because aquaculture is a very new industry in PNG, there's not much people into that kind of industry yet. So we believe that once Jonah is on his feet, then we can pull out. Once he's like economically secure, there's a strong market and he can run things on his own. But at the moment, we have to support these kind of people, lead farmers in PNG.
The Serenumu Agriculture Project is a model that PNG fisheries authorities are hoping to replicate across the country.
This is a very new kind of thing in PNG. It's the first of its kind, and Jonah is already into it doing it. So I bet with his skills and with all this knowledge, we will still require his input into other farmers so that this knowledge will be transferred.
An adjacent aquaculture project to the tilapia farming is the prawn hatchery project. The project was established with assistance from the Australian Centre for International Agricultural Research, the National Fisheries Agency of PNG, and the South Pacific Community. The hatchery is based here at the University of Papua New Guinea, where the baby prawns are nurtured from the larvae stage right until they're as large as this prawn. And just take a look at it. At the nursery, the indigenous species of prawns are cultured. These prawns are now at the post-larvae stage and are ready for the grow-out ponds.
This is the last stage in the hatchery before they goes out into the grow-out ponds or grow-out cages. So from this, at 12 ppt, they are reduced down to 0 ppt to acclimatize them slowly before they go up into the pond or in the cages.
PNG's largest university, which supports the project, believes that aquaculture has the potential to become a large-scale industry if backed by the authorities.
Objectives here to put the hatchery at the university is one, of course, for the project itself, you know, to study the life cycle of this prawn, or you know, the freshwater shrimp. That's one. And second is to transfer this technology, you know, from Fiji to here, so that we should be able to, you know, use that for commercial purposes. Yeah. You know, food security is very important in the country. I don't know about Fiji, you already have this technology or aquaculturing or maybe a species, you know, freshwater species already, but in PNG this is the first of its kind. And then third, once the project is completed within 2 years, this facility will be kept at the university and we can continue the facility for other, you know, research purposes.
The prawn cultivation is crucial for PNG's aquaculture industry for many reasons, the most important being food security.
You know, we have 8 million people already, yeah? And I'm pretty sure the food security will become an issue in 10 years' time or 20. So such things like agriculture of those, you know, species that provide proteins, they're very, very important, you know? We have all the infrastructure here. You know, we got ponds, we got water, we got, you know, these indigenous species like the shrimp, it's an indigenous species. Yeah, you don't find it around the world. So this is very, very important. You know, I'm pretty sure when you come back here around after 5 years' time, you're going to see the products of those.
And these baby prawns are now ready for caged farming. They will be raised alongside the tilapia here at the Serenumu Dam. It's because of the hard work and effort put in by passionate farmers like Jonah that other agencies within PNG are beginning to believe in the Serenumu Dam Cage Culture Project. Jonah's business's success has brought about renewed interest in aquaculture here in PNG.
Because of this cluster group, we managed to help him in drafting this proposal for assistance from the government. So instead of him doing it alone through this EU IACT and SPC assistance, we managed to assist him, and now they're willing to help him out with about 300,000 to 500,000 kina for this project. So with the initial assistance from EU, the National Development Bank, is willing to pump in more money to assist them because they see the potential for this sustainable livelihood for the people of Sirmung.
It's the kind of success the European Union hopes businesses like the Farmers Cluster Group here in PNG can expand on to grow beyond the financial and technical assistance into successful ventures in their own right.
I think that's true, but I think it's important to emphasize that IACT can only do so much. I mean, the real burden of the work is with the companies themselves, and which is why I'm so impressed that a lot of the companies have been very successful in their efforts, you know, pushed by IACT. Certainly IACT has done a lot to, let's say, sow the seeds of their success, but the success is due to the companies themselves, and they've really taken advantage of the opportunities which are out there. And IACT is not going to be around forever. We don't have endless pots of money available, so it's going to be up to the companies, up to the private sector, to ensure that they build on the successes that IACT has enabled them to have so far.
Understanding the ABCs of running a business is hardly easy. But if small entrepreneurs take up the challenge with determination and zeal, there's endless opportunities for growth.
Just do your research. There are opportunities out there. There's a lot of money to be made from Pacific products. Don't jump before you know that the water is going to be warm. And I think IACT really does play an important role in making companies ready for this very important leap forward into international markets. And certainly IACT is also working to help companies exploit the domestic markets in the countries in which they've been set up.
Jonah too has big dreams for his little aquaculture farm here in the middle of the Sirinuwu Dam. He hopes one day this modest tilapia and prawn farm will be the largest in the region. And who says it's a far-fetched dream?
To be a farmer, it's not an easy thing. You know, you have to find means and ways. You know, there is always you have to go through problems, hard times and times. But as you go along, you will try to move into. But I just like to support especially the other farmers, especially like Fiji and Papua New Guinea. You know, to become a fish farmer, it's not an easy thing. You have to have commitment on actually on what you are doing. And this will make you to be somebody in the future.
As we depart Sirinuwu Dam, the sun sets in all its glory. Breathtaking, to say the least. But it's the pleasant encounter with zealous individuals like Jonah and his cluster of hardworking farmers that somewhat lingers on. And what good would it be if we didn't give you a sneak peek on what our team had for dinner later on? Of course, it was tilapia on the menu. All we can say is, well done, Jonah.
That's the show for this week. We'd love to hear from you, so do send us an email, talkbusiness@fijitv.com.fj. Remember, you can catch me on the net on our YouTube channel as well as our Facebook page. And if you have a Twitter account, follow me at @RachnaFijiTV. Thank you for joining us. Do join us again at the same time next week. Until then, have a productive week.